The Azure SDK for Go provides the packages you need to use the Azure REST APIs for managing and using Azure services. There's a collection of these samples on GitHub that'll show you how to use the SDK. And Joel Hendrix is here to demo and explain how it works today on Azure Friday. Welcome to Azure Friday. I'm Erik St. and today with me I have Joel Hendrix, who's going to teach us all about the Go SDK for Azure.
Hi, Erik. It's great to be here.
So let's talk a bit about the Azure SDK and what we can use it for.
Yeah. So all of our Azure services are documented in Open API Specs, also known as Swagger. And so we generate a variety of SDKs from the Swagger specs, and the one I work on is in the Go programming language. So any services that Azure exposes through Open API, we're able to generate Go code, and then consumers can use that in their applications.
And what might you want to use these things for?
Well, you know, it really depends. Managing Azure services, like creating containers, VMs, websites, to like data plane operations like blob storage, key vault, interacting with a Redis cache. It's just almost every service that we've got available is exposed through our SDK.
Oh, that's great. And I think you said you had a demo?
I do. So let's bring up VS Code here. So this is a demo creating a container instance service through Azure. So there's a couple things here to notice. So the first thing is we're using the container instance package from the 2018 0601 API version. So I'd like to talk just a little bit more about that. So if you look at our Swagger specs, so here, these are our Open API specs I was talking about earlier. And as you can see, we've got different API versions. And from these, we generate Go packages. So you might wonder, well, there's a lot of API versions here. How do I know which one I want to pick? Well, if it's new code, you probably want to pick the latest one. And if you're migrating existing services that use an older API version, you can completely stick with that API version for, you know, as long as it's available. And we partition them this way so that as new API versions are introduced, which might contain breaking changes, it keeps your code isolated from that. So if I'm consuming 2018 0601, container instance service creates, they want to add some new functionality that might include breaking changes from this version. They might release like a 2018 0901, completely side by side with your code, and you're not going to be impacted by that at all.
Now, these other versions, are these basically, are these set, or will updates, like for bug fixes and things that don't have breaking changes, will those occur within these?
So yes, they will. And sadly, sometimes we will see breaking changes in here from time to time. It's rare, but it does happen for a handful of reasons. But mostly you will see bug fixes and no breaking changes at all.
Okay.
So let's continue here. So going back to the demo code. So here we're importing the container instance package and the resources package that we can use to create a resource group. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to create what we call an authorizer. And this is what's used to authenticate with Azure to get you an access token so that you can actually consume the services. So we've tried to make this simpler. Over the last couple of months, there was a lot of boilerplate code that you ended up copying, pasting between projects, and we said, well, let's just see if we can put something in the box so you don't have to do that. So we added this new function called new authorizer from environment. And if we go look at this guy, so he'll look in a couple different places to try and find credentials through environment variables. So client credentials like your client ID, your client secret, certificate if you're using certificate authentication, username, password for some Azure services if you don't have like 2FA enabled, and then finally MSI authentication if your app is actually running in a VM inside of Azure and is using managed services identity. So with that, really all you need to do is call this function, and it will look through your environment, and it will find what you've got set, and it will create an authorizer from that. And so next, what we do is from our resources package, we create a new groups client. And this is what we can actually use to create a new resource group. So for our demo here, we'll be creating a resource group called Demos Group 1. And let's see. And then, so we call Creator Update, which starts the asynchronous operation to create the resource group. And then we use Go's defer statement to defer deleting the resource group until the very end. So this will run once the main function exits and will clean up all the resources that we created.
So essentially the program's just creating a resource group at the beginning, then everything it does, and at the very end it's gonna just delete the resource group and just clean up anything that it created inside of whatever it did.
Exactly. And so one of the things I wanna call out here, so we have these asynchronous operations, or sometimes we call them long-running operations, LROs for short. And there's a couple different patterns that you can use for that, depending. So if we look at delete, you'll see here it returns this groups delete future. Since we don't really care to wait for the resource group to finish deleting for the purposes of this demo, we just call delete, and then we exit. So it's you know, fire and forget. So next, what we do is we are going to create a container groups client. And so here's where we use this authorizer that we created above. And so here's our create long running operations. So here we actually do, we capture the future that's returned from us because we need to wait. We want to wait for this thing when it's done so that we can do some stuff after it. So originally we used to return these things back through channels. It was clunky, didn't work too well. People weren't too happy with it. So we have this whole future concept to capture asynchronous operations. So the future that's returned, you can do a couple different things with it. So the first one that we saw was like this, just fire and forget. Like if you're deleting a resource group and you don't need to block on waiting for that to be completed, you just call the operation and you move on with your code. So here, since we actually want to wait for the creation to complete, we call this wait for completion ref on the future that was returned to us. And by default, it will wait for for 15 minutes that's configured on the default client. Now, there's been a couple times where I've seen some things that take a really long time to deploy. So you can change this polling duration if you need to. So you can see here, I've got an example of how you might set it to 20 minutes. So here we wait for this to complete. And then we have another pattern as well with the future. So maybe you don't want to block. You want to maybe do some other work while it's going, but you need to come back and check the status from time to time, because eventually you do care when the operation is completed. So what you can do is you can call the future and say, hey, are you done? Future is going to say it's going to check with the asynchronous operation on Azure, and you're going to get back a response, yes, no. So if you're not done, then maybe we can do some other stuff while we're waiting. Maybe we want to, I don't know, print the status or send it to a logger or what have you. And then, you know, and then we're going to loop around and try again. And then finally, once we've created our container group, we can list them. And so one of the other things that we added was this for pageable operations. So some data sets might give you back information in pages, so like maybe like 10 at a time, 100
at a time.
You've got
10,000 users and you're trying to iterate over all of them.
Exactly. So those APIs will return a page, and then you can just kind of iterate over the page. You can ask it if it's, you know, does it have more information? And if it does, then you just move to the next page, and then that page will give you the range of values. Now this kind of chunks it up into, you'll notice this value here is a slice of container groups. So maybe you might care to keep everything segregated page by page. We also have this, we also generate this method called it'll have a suffix of complete, and that returns an iterator, and that will just seamlessly move across page boundaries as required. So if you have 10,000 users, and you just want to iterate over, and you don't care about the page boundaries, Iterator is a great option to do that. And so if we...
So you don't really know that behind the scenes it's going out and fetching a new page. You're just iterating over each individual thing.
That's
as
correct.
If you had, you know, the entire collection at once.
Right. Exactly. And so if we, we can run our example here. It will take a little while because creating this container group takes about a couple minutes or so. But it'll just kind of run in the background while we... And I've already, so in this command window, I've already set up all my environment variables with all of my credentials. So the authorizer knows to look for a client ID and a client secret, tenant ID, those kinds of things.
Just looking for it in like its default locations.
Correct.
And now the application itself is just going to go out and create just a container group inside of ACI?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. And if we, so we can go kind of peek on this while it's running. So if we go look at our resource group, here's this demo resource group one that the app created. And here is the container group that is, oh, status is running. Maybe that means that it's finished deploying. Oh, it seems like it's still kind of waiting for it to complete. So, and then once this, oh, done.
And we're done.
And so it lists, it. We grabbed back the page. It was only one thing that it found, of course, because
right.
we only created the one. And if we go back, we should see that our resource group is, well, it's probably in progress of being, deleting, as you can see there.
So it's cleaning up after itself, as
yep.
we kind of said with that defer statement. Today, we were learning about the Azure SDK for Go here on Azure Friday.